They say that tradition and heritage are what make a luxury sedan. But is that truly the case? Or could luxury simply be defined by the way something looks, the way it feels, the way it makes you feel? Perhaps it's the way it makes others feel about you. While some will cling to the notion that history is what makes a luxury sedan, the open-minded will form an opinion of their own. I'm not here to tell you what luxury is or what it isn't. That is up to you. I am merely here to show you the door and the state-of-the-art onboard technology and the meticulously crafted interior and the premium Napa leather trimmed reclining rear seats. So what is luxury? The only way to truly know is to open the door.
My only question is, how does he keep those glasses on? I'd love to be on the set to see how he figures that out. And also, I just want to remind everybody, this is a key event, so make sure you take the red pill, not the blue pill, which is another brand. I'm going to take you through the product briefing really quick. First off, I'd like to recognize my team, Eddie Rand, who is our product manager for the K900. Endless nights of toiling on many assignments to help us bring this car to market. Henry Bizet, our chief technology strategist, he'll be handy and available to discuss the Yugo features and some of the infotainment. And Ralph, I don't know if you're back there, Ralph Choa, who's head of our car group, is also available for us to discuss. Interesting point for us on bringing this car to market. The irony of the whole thing is the impetus of this car and bringing out a premium luxury Kia started in the middle of the recession, which I think is just a fascinating story. And it started with the introduction of our 2D cars coming out of our KMMG plant down in Georgia. We introduced the Sorento first and then the Optima. And both of those, when we introduced them, they were fully competitive, state-of-the-art cars. What we found, though, as Michael had mentioned, this influx of other buyers coming in. We had an unexpectedly high mix of both of those vehicles. And that kind of started us thinking that there was a change afoot. When we did the research to study this space, it also gave us the impetus to add the Cadenza to the lineup. And I think many of you were with us last year. It's been out in the market for almost a year now. The car is doing fantastic. And that arc of adding premium vehicles to the Kia lineup culminates with the introduction of the K900. And for us, as the product pioneers who worked on this team, when the assignment came to us to bring this car to the North American market, we really focused on four key areas to enter this very established space with some formidable competitors in the space. Design, luxury, performance, and technology. Those were the key areas that we focused on to really put together what we consider to be the compelling offer that comes from Kia in entering this space. And it all starts with the design. For us, the key part of the design was twofold. Number one, it had to have the presence and the look and the design of a luxury car. And this, for us, was very important. As you look at the car from across the parking lot, as you're approaching it, if you're seeing it coming across at you in traffic, and as you see it in settings like this luxury resort, it has to kind of look the part. So we put a lot of effort into the design, the stance, and the proportion, and to make sure that it has that presence. So for us, it really came down to three elements: design for distinctiveness, modern, and timelessness. And that really kind of sums up the areas that we were looking at. And it all starts off with this great stance and proportion that you can only get with the rear drive platform. This generous 119.9-inch wheelbase gives us a straight space between the wheels. Really nice front and rear overhang. It's just this really nice proportion that when we did our studies on the packaging, is very similar to the other established brands out there. So from a visual cue standpoint, the vehicle looks the part. And it also, as you approach the vehicle a bit closer, we added elegant, new sophisticated touches, like a new interpretation of what we refer to as our signature grille. This is a face that, if you look at all of our Kia cars, Peter Schreier was very keen on making sure that there's a family resemblance that goes through the entire lineup. And this car, of course, is one of our key elements. And it also has a unique presence. If you come up behind the vehicle, this kind of confidence that has nice stance over the wheels, this great broad shoulder line. and a nice line that goes across the back of the vehicle, and also adds very sophisticated details such as LED lighting around the entire perimeter of the vehicle. Matter of fact, every light on the car except for the backup lights is in fact LED, and these beautiful elements we saw at dinner last night, we had it illuminated. They're all LED of 16 elements, so we've got four bulbs of four each. LED standard on every K900, and the lighting color has been carefully tuned to mimic natural sunlight as much as possible. So it's a great feature and a great add. And the story continues, of course, with the interior, which is where obviously you look at the outside, but you spend most of the time on the interior. For us, it was first and foremost had to be in line with the exterior, both modern and sophisticated, but also a lot of attention to the detail and the materials to give this kind of warm and inviting ambiance for the driver and four other passengers in the vehicle. So it's very roomy. And that also starts first and foremost with the materials. I mean, this is a space that has a lot of competition and a lot of heritage, and we came into it knowing this. In fact, we spent a lot of time and effort finding a supplier and a vendor and a supply chain that can supply us with the Napa leather that we needed. It took us almost 3 years to get the material right. The hides come from South America. They are finished with a non-chromium process, which was really important for us. A lot of work goes into the buffing techniques to get the right hand and the right luster and the right finish. And wait till you touch it, it's just amazing material. Natural wood accents, 16-way power driver seat, and a panoramic sunroof standard on every K900. And also for us, heated front and rear seats, and also a new feature that we're adding, which is a tri-zone system. So there's dual HVAC systems for the front, but also a separate zone for the rear seat that you'll get to see today. Speaking of the rear seat, this is for us probably one of the biggest unique selling points for the car. It's very accommodating, it's a huge rear seat. Be sure you spend some time back there. In fact, the rear seat package on this vehicle is larger than just about everything else in the segment, including our main players. And in addition to the space and the size, it also includes some really nifty features. Individually reclining seats that we saw on the spot with Lawrence Fishburne, adjustable wing headrests, very similar to what you'd find in a first-class airliner on an international flight, privacy shades for the side and also for the rear. And for the vehicles you'll be driving today, which is the up-level VIP package, we've included controls in the center console that manage both the temperature, but also heated and cooled and power lumbar for the rear seats. All that's controlled right there in the center console. It's truly amazing. Wait till you check it out. Also, power access. We have a power deck lid that goes up and down with a touch of a button. And also a new valet key that we're adding to first time for Kia. It's about the thickness of a credit card for a lot of folks who don't want to bring a key fob with them. If it can slip into a pocket or purse, it's very high tech and modern. And also a soft door close. So auto sense, you can just push the doors close to the seating position and there's a motor that pulls it in, which is a very nice luxury touch. The performance story for the vehicle really starts off with the basics, which is one of the key ingredients for this category, which is a front engine rear drive platform. And it seems obvious and intuitive, but some other luxury brands don't even have that in their lineup. So we made the effort to make sure that this is where we started off with this vehicle. It's a world-class platform. In addition to the 119-inch wheelbase I've already mentioned, it has nearly perfect balance, 52 up front, 48 rear. And you'll feel it when you drive it today. The car is very composed, it's very smooth, and in the cornering, it doesn't tip over. It's a nice overall package. And also, in addition to that, a very, very rigid body and light. In this structure, a lot of time and effort has gone into maximizing the overall rigidity. And it comes down to a couple of key points. First is extensive use of high strength and also ultra high strength steel, and about 75% for the overall body and light, which is a remarkable number. Also includes a hot stamping process. This is a difficult material to work with. It's basically turns brittle. It's not very flexible once it's cooled off. So our engineers have put a lot of time and effort to make sure that the dimensions stay true down to a millimeter as the body gets formed. So that's a major technological feat. We've highlighted one specific area. This is the center pillar ring that goes over through the beam pillars and over the front crossbow. And this just kind of illustrates one specific area that we've added to the vehicle to enhance not only the rigidity, but also the safety for side impacts. Also for us, it's the first time we're adding a V8 engine to our sedan lineup. Here, this is the Tau. We call it the Tau engine family. It's a 5-liter displacement direct injected engine. 11.5 compression ratio. It has variable cams on both the intake and the exhaust. Continuously variable, which gives us this fantastic flat torque curve that you'll get to experience today. Good for 420 horsepower and 376 pound-feet of torque. It's a fantastic engine. And mated to that is an in-house, specifically designed and developed for this platform. This is one that was designed by Kia, developed, and also introduced for this car, 8-speed automatic transmission. It's a new compact, lightweight design, and the valve body and the servos were specifically designed for quick shifting and very quick downshifts and responsiveness. And the other added bonus, because it's a new design, is we're able to integrate some electronic controls in there. So you can change with the drive mode, it'll change the shift schedule and also the responsiveness of the transmission, depending on what drive mode that you're in. The other part of the story is the handling story, and you'll feel it today. This is an area that obviously for this category, for this level of buyer, it has to be the best, and we spared no expense here. It's the chassis rides on a fully independent front and rear 5-link aluminum suspension system, and we specifically selected aluminum mainly to do two things. Number one, to reduce the unsprung weight and to make it a little bit more responsive, but also for packaging efficiency. The tires, they're 19-inch tires standard for the front and rear. They're staggered, which means that the rears are slightly larger with a different aspect ratio. And this is to maximize the effectiveness during handling, and also four piston front brakes for the K900. And probably the one feature that once we start driving will impress you the most is the NVH package. It's just phenomenal in the car. A lot of time and effort has gone into, in addition to making the body rigid and sophisticated and also great handling, is also to concentrate on those areas where the sound starts, where it emanates from. So we first off traced down to over 200 different points that were isolated and either covered or coated with some processes to eliminate friction and the source of sound. For those sounds, the sound that does come in the vehicle, it has an extensive use of sound deadening materials underneath the floor, on the side, and also the headliner to stop the sounds that's coming in, including kind of a lot of work that went on underneath the vehicle. If you think about airflow underneath the vehicle and all the nooks and crannies that air can get hung up on, the exhaust system and brackets and fuel tanks and all that stuff, it is a significant source of kind of a low frequency rumbling sound. So we added full length belly pans underneath the vehicle to manage the airflow to help obviously the drag efficiency, the coefficient of drag, but also the benefit here is that it reduces that low grade rumbling sound. And you'll hear it today when you drive the vehicles. It's an incredibly quiet vehicle. We had some of the folks from the first wave I rode with, we stopped at the stoplight and the guy in front says, well, does this have ISG? Does this have a start stop? I said, no, the engine's running. It's just that quiet. It's really, really, truly remarkable. Laminated glass, both for the front windshield and also the side windows. And the final point is the technology story, which we're really proud of. It starts off with a fantastic multimedia system. The centerpiece is a 9.2-inch multimedia display that's front and center on the center cluster. This houses the Yugo e-services function, as well as some other vehicle functions that's all controlled using this driver information control system. And the benefit here for us was the fact that instead of having a touch screen, you can, sorry about that, Instead of having a touchscreen, which requires the IP to be pulled closer to the body, so that if you're driving, you have to have touch there. We wanted to maximize the availability of space and the feeling of spaciousness. So by using a separate control, you can push that front of the dash quite a bit further forward. And it's a very intuitive system. We spent a lot of time and effort to make it easy to use. And also, our friends at Harman Kardon, who helped us develop an amazing Lexicon 900-watt 17-speaker system with a separate 12-channel digital amplifier. The system is really, really amazing. If you have an MP3 player with you just on your phone, make sure you pair it and demo the system over the course of the drive today. It's an incredible system. Driver assistance is another part of our story. And here I've mentioned we have the LED headlights in the front. These headlights also have new technology, adaptive front lighting system, which will turn up to 12 degrees depending on the steering angle. So if you're approaching a curve or going around a corner and you turn the wheel, the beam path will turn to help you eliminate the path ahead of you instead of just shooting straight ahead, which is neat technology. A lane departure warning system, smart cruise control that is capable of bringing the vehicle to a full and complete stop. It monitors the distance between you and the vehicle in front of you. And if the traffic stops and the dwell of the stopping time is less than a couple of seconds, it'll actually restart the vehicle when traffic picks back up. So it's a new feature. Blind spot detection, rear cross traffic alert, and also a surround view monitor that gives you a 360-degree view of the vehicle when you're in parking situations. And the front camera stays illuminated for up to about 2 miles per hour. So if you're pulling through a drive-through fast food restaurant and you're trying to maneuver a tight space or pulling into a garage at home to make sure that you don't hit the front of the wall in front of you, it's a great feature to have. It's something we're really proud of. And also probably one of the biggest new features that we're adding to the vehicle is a heads-up display. This is a fully color system. It's about almost, I believe, 65,000 different colors that the system can display. And it wasn't just for a G-Wiz technology story. It was also to help minimize driver distraction and critical or key information that for the vehicle operation is displayed on the screen in front of you. You can actually choose using a menu which specific pieces of information you want in front of you. Speedometer, obviously, if you have the cruise control set, it'll tell you. You can see that on the illumination here on the page. If you're changing the distance between you and the vehicle in front with the active cruise control, you can, while you're watching the car in front of you, change it right there in front of you. It also monitors the systems in the vehicle. If anything needs attention, if there's a system, the warning will show right there on the windshield in front of you. If a destination is programmed into the navigation system, the next turn will be shown onto the screen ahead of you, so you don't have to look down at the screen constantly to see what your next turn is. So it's very handy, and we think it's an important point to make sure that the driver's eyes are always on the road instead of messing with the features. Another important story always for Kia is the safety story. It's one of our pillars when we develop vehicles to make sure that we're the best in the industry. Here I've mentioned the reinforced body structure. The other part of the story here is the significant use of what we refer to as crash durable adhesives. And when the body white comes together, when the panels are formed and joined, it's mechanically with pinch welds. But in addition to that, structural adhesive is added to it as a secondary. It's kind of a belt and suspenders approach. This has a twofold benefit. Number one, it helps ensure that the vehicle is structurally a lot stiffer for the torsional rigidity, but also it helps us manage the load paths in case that there's a front end impact or side impact. And here it's illustrated with this light green color. You can see where we've applied extensive use of the crash durable adhesives all through where the different body panels are joined together. I think a total of it's about 85 and a half meters of this material applied throughout the vehicle. It's a great story, and it's one of the technologies we put into the vehicle. 8 advanced airbags, seatbelt pretensioners, and for the first time, we're introducing a new system we refer to as active vehicle safety management. And this is a suite of different systems in the vehicle that are the activities are coordinated to deliver an added level of safety for the driver. And it starts off with monitoring what's going on in front of the vehicle. If the vehicle is approaching a fixed object or you're sliding off the road or something's happening, the vehicle first gives you a warning to let you know something's going on, you need to pay attention. Starts off with a chime and a warning. If nothing happens after that, the second step is it'll actually vibrate the seatbelt. So if the driver's falling asleep or something, it'll get their attention and say, hey, pay attention, something's going on here. And then also at the same time, the brake system pre-pressurizes so that there's maximum effectiveness as soon as the brakes are applied. And then finally, in the event there's an impending collision, seatbelt pretensioners work in conjunction with the stability control system to make sure that there's maximum effectiveness of the passive system. So it's a great safety story, and we're introducing it for the first time on this vehicle for Arkeas. Michael mentioned a little bit about the competitive landscape, and this for wanting to get into a couple of the specifics here. We define this premium space as mid-luxury and also premium luxury. And it's kind of these two different camps. You can think about a 5 Series and a 7 Series, or an E350 and an S-Class. There's a huge chasm between those two. And what we've noticed in our research, and because of the recession, a lot of these folks are rethinking the way they approach these durable good purchases, like a major purchase like an automobile. And what we've noticed is that a lot of the mid-luxury folks would like a larger size. They want a bigger vehicle for whatever reason. They like the statement, or they have larger families, or they just want a more comfortable vehicle. But moving up to the next category is a significant jump. Likewise, the folks at the very top, you know, maybe they don't want to keep making $1,200 or $1,500 lease payments or $120 oil changes every service period. So we see these folks coming down to the mid-luxury. And we've heard over and over in our research that, well, I really liked the fact that I had a bigger car for my clients or taking the family out. Now we're in a smaller car because it's more affordable. But so there was this kind of this white space in between that we identified, which is where we're placing the K900. And just to put some numbers to this, the facing, I'll take the BMW, which is the top one here, starts off at about $75,000. Comparably equipped, this is the 740i, so the short wheelbase 7 Series. Comparably equipped to the vehicle you'll be driving today is about $84,000. And the same story for the Audi, the Lexus, and the Mercedes. If you consider that $84,000 compared to where we're bringing this car to market, the V8 VIP that you'll be driving today, we're introducing at $65,500. And that doesn't include the $900 destination and handling charge. But it does include a complimentary 3-year service agreement that goes with the car. So that is part of why we're bringing this car to market, because we really see this opportunity for delivering a premium space for those folks who are at the top end of the market. For instance, on that BMW, it's about a $20,000 savings in delivering the same experience as that big BMW. So overall, for us, we're very proud of that fact. But we're not the only ones who recognize that value story. When we showed the vehicle and demonstrated the vehicle to ALG, which is one of the big arbiters in our industry, they set the residual values for lease bookings, which this segment is probably close to 90% leasing. They have recognized our value story by giving us the denotation of premium luxury residual value leader in this category. That means that we're above everybody else in this category for residual values. Now, that's a really strong endorsement for a newcomer to what is an established space. So overall, it's fully competitive, a true luxury flagship sedan that you'll be experiencing today, superb materials and craftsmanship, and what we feel really is an overall compelling Kia story for the space. We're going to go to market with a relatively straightforward grade strategy. We'll start off with the first level V8, which I described earlier in the presentation, the Napa leather trim, panoramic sunroof, the 19-inch wheels, all those features. It moves up to the vehicle you'll be driving today, which is on display here, which we refer to as the V8 VIP package. That includes a lot of the features that for the rear seat, the recline and the lumbar. In addition to that, it has some other additional features like a fully configurable 12.3-inch TFT display on the instrument cluster in front of you. And you'll try it today. When you change the drive modes, you can see that the skins on the IP change to go along with whatever mode the vehicle is in, and that's available on the up-level package. So that's the K900 story. I know everybody's anxious to get out there and drive the vehicle. What I'd like to do is invite the rest of the team up to help us answer some questions. I know there's probably some questions out there. We have two microphones that will be circulating. If you would raise your hand, wait for the microphone, and then state your name and affiliation, your question. We'll do our best to answer. We have Eddie Ray who's joining us, as well as Henry Bizet. Fire away. So,
hi. Daron Levine, Fortune. Could you tell me whether you're thinking at all about all-wheel drive?
We have thought of it. It's an important feature for the Central and the East region. This vehicle has been in market in Korea. It wasn't developed in the beginning with all-wheel drive, and the amount of effort needed to introduce it would have delayed the program too far. So we did think of it, and we're studying it for a future application.
Jeff Taylor, Chicago Sun-Times. This is directed towards Michael. You talk about perception and so forth. I'm curious to find out what the reaction was from consumer groups and focus groups to the K900 name, because it's one so different from what you currently have, and also does it signal a changeover of numbering going further different model names?
Moving towards more alphanumeric, right? So. The story behind it is, many of you know, in Korea, the vehicle is called the K9. Obviously, that would not work here in the United States. Yeah. We did consider the other name that this vehicle is called in other markets around the world. That's the Corus. The vehicle is sold in Russia, in the Middle East, and a few other countries. In looking at the landscape here in the U.S., we've looked at all of the luxury brands, and 90% of them, I think Cadillac is probably the only one, they all use alphanumeric. So we wanted to immediately send a signal to consumers that this fits within that luxury space. Does that mean all of our vehicles are going to move towards alphanumeric? Absolutely not. We have too much vested in Sportage, in Optima, Forte, in Soul. I mean, we spend hundreds of millions of dollars every year to build up those nameplates, and to go and make a shift would not be very wise from an investment standpoint. So it does send a signal that in terms of our luxury vehicles, more than likely if we introduce other luxury vehicles in the future, they will follow an alphanumeric naming strategy.
Paul Eisenstein from NBC, the Detroit Bureau, and a few others. I wonder if you would talk about what's happening with the luxury segment in general. You've touched on it a few different times. We hear more and more about the wealth gap and more people being priced out of the market. Can you touch about what you see in general in the luxury market and what that means for the industry if people are in fact being priced out while luxury makers in many cases move down to try to keep up with them?
I'm not sure. What do you mean priced out?
Well, more and more you're seeing with the wealth gap, more and more middle-class consumers are being priced out of the market for new vehicles in general, never mind luxury vehicles. In many cases, people are switching over to nearly new vehicles and the like. So I wonder if you could talk in general about what you're seeing with the luxury market.
Actually, I think Eddie has some facts on that. Over the last, 5 years in terms of the average transaction price in that premium luxury space?
Yeah, so in the past, since the recession, the price of premium luxury vehicles, the S-Class BMW 7 Series, has the rate of price increases 3 times faster than the average price of mainstream brands. So we feel that the K900 does deliver a little bit more sensibility into the premium luxury segment, where other cars, some of the European cars, are a much higher rate of increase in terms of pricing. So it gives a great opportunity for the K900. Does that help answer your question? So the rate of price increase is much, much higher for the premium luxury vehicles than the average price since the time of the recession.
I'm also talking about what's happening in general, people being priced out of the market, and manufacturers, traditional luxury makers, trying to go after the new consumer, since it seems many people simply can't afford to go into luxury anymore, or they're trying just simply to broaden it. There's so many things happening in the luxury market, both top and bottom.
I mean, we had a 16 million industry, we're moving towards a 16 million industry, so that tells me consumers are buying products. I mean, as we mentioned, the premium Lux and the mid-Lux both grew in 2013. We do see Mercedes moving down into the sub 30,000, to get a broader reach of consumers. So maybe you and I can talk about it afterward to help me understand.
Yeah.
What data you're looking at.
Yes, good morning. Jim Breeder, AAA, the American Automobile Association. Many of your competitors have a long version. Any thoughts on that? And then would you comment on the styling of the little Venta port on the side? Looks just a different
Well, we
are, design. Thank you.
Our wheelbase is 119.9, so we actually are competitive with below wheelbase versions. In the presentation I mentioned the 740i, they have two wheelbases. The Benz for this generation, the S-Class, they bring only the long wheelbase to the U.S. market. So, and if you look across the entire lineup, it's predominantly the longer wheelbase. So this is fully competitive with that category. The Benz is just it's a design element. It's just adds a touch to the side of the vehicle for some design interest on the scale and size of the car.
Jacob Brown, automotive.com. I was just wondering when the V6 models were coming out, and if we could get any indication of pricing on them.
Yeah, so at the LA Auto Show, we said the V6 pricing will start around $50,000. We are making a concerted effort to put our best foot forward first, and we believe the V8 VIP is really where we want to showcase to consumers what the car is and what the brand can do. The V6 will come a little bit later. So we're launching this right in the next couple of weeks. Some vehicles are on the boats headed over. So the V6 will follow in a few months.
Okay, back. Aaron Gold, Dog Grooming Weekly, Lifestyle Magazine. What is that residual value that ALG set?
The number that they gave us was 52% for a 36 month lease. And that compares to others in the marketplace. The BMW is actually down around 46-47%. I've got the actual numbers. See me after the meeting, I'll give you the actual numbers.
Just as a follow-up to your naming story, which is kind of cute and interesting, did your Korean colleagues ever explain to you how they got to K9, what that actually denotes in Korea? I'm curious, does K have some relation to Korea, or 9 have some significance? Why did they call it K9?
They have an alphanumeric strategy there, so they have a K3, the K is Kia. So they have a K3, a K5, a K7, and a K9. So in their market, it made perfect sense.
Interesting.
Thank you.
Carl, up here.
Yeah, I'm Carl Brower with Kelly Blue Book. You talked about the wheelbase and how it's comparable to the long wheelbase luxury stance. I'm curious about the interior volume. I don't know if you have, I don't have the number on, memorized, but interior volume-wise, how does it stack up compared to a long wheelbase 7? Any of you have it memorized?
So, interior volume on this vehicle is larger than the Lexus LS, BMW 7 Series short wheelbase, and the Audi A8, so 111 cubic feet for the passenger volume. So we're very competitive, just about every dimension.
Okay, any other questions? Yeah. Paul?
There's one that seems obvious we haven't touched on. Obviously, you're using the Equus, the same basic platform as the Equus. So let's talk about the difference between the two vehicles, whether it's dynamics, construction, electronics, and so on. How do you plan to separate the two?
You're right. It does use many of the components within our corporate family. For us, the main differences are we have the same wheelbase as the Equus at 119.9. We have an overall shorter length. It's shorter by about 2.5 inches. And for us, that was more to signal a tighter, more modern overall proportion and package. However, we have more interior room, so it's kind of an interesting combination there. We have more front seat leg room and head room, and slightly less leg room in the rear than the Atlas. From a suspension standpoint, they use an airbag type suspension. We use a coilover suspension, and then also there's some other small spec differences.
We also have
a great looking car. We have, but I might be a little biased. And we have, from a technology standpoint, we have U-boat as well, so consumers can bring their vehicles in, whereas I think they have a different technology where you have to purchase a subscription system. So it goes back to that value story as well.
So Orth took you through the kind of the detail by detail. I think overall, we all know in the car business, people shop first with their eyes. So the design is a huge factor in this, and that goes from exterior to interior, so it's the touch points. And then we also did talk about the suspension and the tuning, so that shift schedule, that throttle mapping, that the ride and handling is all designed for the Kia, to be in keeping with the Kia brand and to appeal to the Kia buyer, which is very different than Hyundai.